Okay, so let me introduce myself first. I am Janna Siebert, and I work in clay and glass. I wish we were in person because that would be a lot more fun. But as of now, I'm going to tell you I've maintained two bodies of work. Most of my time is devoted to sculptures, and these are just one part of my sculpture, and you'll see that later on today. So with my functional, I kind of reference to back to arts and crafts movement and also Art Nouveau. With this section, 30-minute section, I'm hoping to help you see how to throw on the wheel and also to show you my installation because I'm an installation artist. So this one is, you can look at this and say this is contemporary because of the color fields in the back and then because of the way it was set up. As artists, we take different inspirations from our life and oftentimes observations. And those are important tools. So if I can direct your attention to the PowerPoint, you can see Nike. She is from Greek mythology, and she is the personification of victory. In recent years, there have been quite a few deaths in my family due to cancers. And so during the process of healing, I decided to make something because that's how I express and to deal with grief. So in the sculpture that I had done last year, 2019, you can see a few healthy cells sitting on a cancer cell. And for me, that's a symbol of victory, and it helps me in the healing process. And so I took inspirations from Nike. So at first glance, you don't see it. In the one is an iconography, right, from 3,000 years ago. But the other one is so modern. This is basically done just last year. But you can see I took the reference from the wings and also the base. And the protruding of the body is represented to the right side of my sculpture. So it's not direct reference. But this is where I found points where I could connect from an icon to a contemporary work.
I hope what I have to share about my studio process will benefit you and inspire you. And throughout the time we have together, I would like you to think about those questions. Number one is to find your voice in the contemporary art world based on historical research. And the second one is create work that can start a dialogue between you and the audience or the audience itself, and that puts your work relevant to nowadays, the art that's going on. And try to recontextualize your work. For instance, I mentioned earlier I applied the color fields, but this is not really the color field. This is my way, my interpretation of the color field, so I made this my own. So that's what I mean by recontextualize your work to be relevant. And then, so find your subject matter too. Find something that can inspire you and can keep you excited and be passionate about. For instance, the way I work with microorganisms, like a virus or a diatom. I am passionate about art and science. So my resources come from these two combined. And consider art as a language. And also try to, I think, to find inspiration from traditional sources. That's important because that's the base of your art practice. But think outside the box. And so when you think outside the box, you can bring the meaning in, which is recontextualized by the way your interpretation of your work. And then you will create some dialogue between you and your audience. And your work, your art will be so meaningful and so wonderful. So I'm just preparing the clay for throwing. So this is about 1.5 pounds of clay. Maybe 1.5 pounds about. And so I start with this amount of clay and I'm getting the air out. It's called wedging. And so by the time I'm done, I want to weigh about 0.5 pound. Otherwise, with the milk and cereal, this ball is going to be very, very thick. And then, I'll show you this again. So this is called trimming.
And I'll show you later to kind of connect these two together. But prepare the clay. So before I sit down and draw, I usually have to look, I sketch in my book. And so this one tells me that the shape of the vessel and the way I would decorate is it's color field. And oftentimes that's how I do my surface to connect with contemporary art, is by doing this. And so those are some shapes I draw out, have drawn, and I put this in front of the wheel so it gives me a nice reference. So like this, it's I kind of changed this form from a Chinese influence. I was looking at Song Dynasty, that's 2500 BC. And this was actually out of bronze, but I decided to kind of change into clay. So it's really fun to do things like that. Just kind of take a historical reference and make it your own. The first thing to do is to put this down in the middle and brace yourself so your body is not moved by this wheel. So we're gonna go up and down. That's how we center. So look at my elbows, they're not moving, and my wrists are not really influenced by the wheel. So I'm going down, come up again, go down. And since I'm making the vessel I just showed you, so I know my base is gonna be about this wide. And for me, the ease of using or even like be able to wash it, those are all in my design element for me. So if I make this one for somebody who doesn't have a dishwasher, but the opening is this small, it's really hard to go in and wash. So for me, that's a place where you need to be sensitive to other people's needs. And also think about who will be using this cup. If it's a man of 200 pounds and 6 feet, then a tiny little thing is not gonna cut it, right? It just looks awkward, the proportion is out, it's kind of off. But for somebody like me, you know, 100 pounds and 5'2", this is perfect. So think about who will be using this cup. And once that's deep enough, I'm gonna go in with my needle tool, and that's 1/4 inch. I don't know if you can see that. Oh, it's better that. It's better that way. So this thickness is awesome. It's what I like. So once your cylinder is opened, you want to use a sponge to come back. You can use your finger as well. Just kind of go back and forth to compress the molecules. So just to prevent S cracks, which will happen in the kiln. Just give it some water. And then the way I like it is, I like to set it up very easy and nice for my, just plan to throw a couple hours without fatigue. So I relax my finger, my inside finger. Oftentimes my students would actually, they kind of hold it so tight and their fingers are really, really rigid, which when the fingers are extended like this, I tell them, this is what I tell them, it's flying fingers. When you have flying fingers, you have less control. So I don't want to have any flying fingers, so they're all inside. And I like to kind of look at the wheel as a clock. So that's my 12 o'clock, this is my 6 o'clock, 3 o'clock. And the best place, location to throw is between 3 and 6 o'clock. So find your place. So for me, it's about 4:30. Here is where I can control my body the best. And when I embrace myself, my elbows are not moving, so it's about here. So find your place. So I'm gonna basically like squeezing the clay between my fingers and come up. And come up in a very consistent speed. And when you come to the top, try to compress the rim a little bit, because that helps to define that area and also prevents cracks. Sometimes when the rim is too thin, it just cracks. For a small cylinder like this, I like to get it done in 3-4 pulls.
And some of you might be experiencing this. It's the drawing at the beginning is not as easy, but just keep at it. It will happen. And when it happens, it's so fun. You can just come sit down with a lump of clay, and 20 minutes after, it's a beautiful cup, or like 5 minutes after, you have a beautiful cup. I normally don't throw anything around it. I try to change the shape. So this is my third pull, and I'm pushing the clay in so I can use that clay to give me more height. Same thing, basically just a few passes. And for my students, I want them to go to 6 inches. Compress the rim, same thing. Sometimes I like to use my finger like that, just it gives that very nice rounded rim. So I'm still trying to pull it up. As soon as I can connect my fingers, do you see my left thumb is resting on the sponge? So the reason for doing that is just so it's you give yourself as much stability as possible. So basically this is done. But for me, because I like to paint on my cups, I'll take away all the drawing rings from the outside. I just knock that out. So basically just kind of bring it back. It's super simple. And so this one helps to kind of make the outside look like a canvas. So when I'm painting on this, the drawing line is not gonna distract from the design I put on my plate. So this basically is done. So let me show you what it looks like. Cutting wires, just be careful because sometimes they can cut. So I want you to see this. Do you see the evenness on the wall? And that's what you want. You want to have some evenness. So the throwing convention is the same. You brace yourself, stick your elbows in, and don't move. So same thing, come up and down. Sorry about the wheel, it's making a lot of noise, huh? Because I know this is gonna be a bowl, so I'm gonna push down more to give me a wider base for a bowl. Opening, same thing, except I kind of give it a more wider angle for me to see what's going on. So now this time, besides the thickness of the body, that's too thick. So I'll show you. So that's about 1/2 inch, right? So that accounts for the foot and the bottom. So you can see this is a trim ball, and I broke this up to show my students. So you want to trim it to even thickness. And then the bottom here is about 1/4 inch, and this whole thing is about 5/8. So this one gives you the foot, okay? And so I'm accounting for that too. Opening. And the first thing I do is to establish the curvature inside. So I utilize this curve to give me a very nice continual curvature. So when you're eating your cereal, your spoon is not gonna skip. I think that's most annoying. So you can see the inside is, the curvature is very, very nice, and that's the most important thing, at least in my book, when you throw a ball. And I require my students to actually make this really, really important. I don't want them to have
an interior that kind of just bumps. And then another thing about bowls is, for the other forms, you'll see in the outside. But for a bowl, you'll see in the inside. So this is the most important part, okay? So from here, it's about the same. I'm utilizing the angle of my fingers, and then bring this up. Come to the top, compress your rim. And here you can see the bottom is quite thick, right? The bottom has, it doesn't look anything like a bowl at all. The bottom doesn't look anything. It's because from here on, from about here on, it's gonna be trimmed away. So this part, trimming a bowl is most fun because you actually see the shape take place. It's really, really fun. So you can see I'm leaving a lot of clay at the bottom, right? The reason for that is because if I don't leave that much clay at the bottom, the clay is actually sitting in air, and the clay will just, because the weight, it's gonna collapse when it's too much for the air to support. And that's why we need this clay here, and that's why this clay will be trimmed away. So like I said, by the time this is done, it's gonna be about six ounces. How many ounces are there in a pound? Also be 8, it's half a pound. Sorry about that. Compress the rim. And after about 2 pulls, I like to do this. I'll use 2 ribs. Some people use 1, but I like to use 2 so it's kind of save time. And also I feel like it gives me better control. So I'm using the inside with this small one. And I usually just kind of cut this in half. So I'm doing the inside and the outside together. So you can see the inside. Can you see the curvature? So that's my first pass. And I'll continue the throw, because my goal is to have 2 cups, and that's after fire. So I'm gonna do, this is 12% shrinkage. So I'm gonna do 2 and 4 quarter cup. So I'm bringing this up. Okay, compress the rim. There are a lot of things you kind of get into a habit, and don't worry too much about I'm missing this part and that part, because it doesn't matter. At the beginning, there simply is just too much to remember. So give yourself some allowance. As you're learning, it's fine. Just tell yourself it's fine. I'm learning, and I can only focus on 1 thing or 2 things at a time. And that's okay. So this is my last pull. So I am gonna go back and then run this through the inside again. So you can see the inside. Can you see the inside coming up like this? So you can see my ribs are against each other, right? You can see them kind of working together as a team. Come to the very top, release gently, and come back and compress the rim. And that's your bowl. I'm gonna show you 1 thing though. Can I show you this? So another thing I like to do is to give it a little flair. And the reason why I do that is because I want more space to decorate, to paint. So I have invented this shape years ago. So I just kind of hold the rib in my hand and supporting the clay on the outside. Never push clay into the air because it's gonna collapse. So I'm just kind of pushing this down like this. So now you can see the lines are different, right? It's very, very different. If you have seen the final table on Netflix, they do this a lot. So they'll put their precious food in the center and just elevates the food. It's wonderful. So sometimes I'll do these kind of forms too. So I have this extra band to decorate. And so I'll decorate here and then the outside as well. So So that's how we make bowls in two ways.
I've tried so hard, my dear, to show that you're my every dream. Yet you're afraid each thing I do is just some evil scheme.
So mixing glazes is a big part of my studio practice. I mix my glazes to fit the clay body of my sculpture to highlight the texture and to convey the intention of my installation. There are a lot of applications from your current study, studying in high school. I use algebra, chemistry all the time. Knowing what chemicals will behave in a hot kiln is a huge plus. And since you are in ceramics, you know the final color of the sculpture is not necessarily the color of your glaze. And I think part of the intrigue about ceramics is you can predict all things, and that's why knowledge is so essential in ceramics or working in clay. So when I test a lot of glazes, and when I fire, I take very close notes. For instance, it says 15 cups of water, three times 15 cups of water, so I can repeat the result. And I feel it's very important, if you want to have the same result, you have to keep good notes. So now I want to show you something that's kind of ugly of my studio practice. This is my casting table. It's just a regular table, it's not the fancy one. And then this is called slip. So this, I'll scoop the slip with that container and put it onto my mold. So I designed all of my molds. So you can see this one gives me this form. And then these two, the one with the slip in, gives me this form. And I join them together. And then this one gives me this. So I designed all of my molds, and some are very simple like this one, because you can see the texture is quite simple on this one. But some of them have, oh, this one doesn't have a lot of pattern here, but I have one that it's really, really crazy. So I designed the molds, and mold making is very straightforward. You just need to be careful. Just need to be careful with what we call undercut. If it has undercut, these will not come out. It will be stuck inside. Therefore, you cannot use whatever you cast. So this is called slip casting. And this is a huge part of my studio practice. It's fun. It's dirty and it's fun. So firing kiln is a huge part of my studio practice. After they are glazed, you have to put them in the kiln to fire them. And let me show you. So earlier when I was mixing the glazes, I told you about the glaze color might not necessarily be the color that will turn out at the end. So you can see the example. This is dusty, very dusty, and almost has a sienna color, but it comes out this color. So they don't necessarily turn out the same thing, same color. And then another thing is, do you see here I'm using this? It's called stilts. So we use this to kind of prop the work up, and the reason for that is because once the kiln reaches temperature, the glaze will melt. And if you didn't put them on the stilts and put them on the shelves, as it cools down in the process of cooling, it will stick to the shelf, which is something we don't want. Because that then it means you lose not only this piece, but also the shelf, and the shelves are kind of expensive. So yeah, it's very exciting to load the kiln and open the kiln. One of the most exciting process in the studio is opening the kiln, and it's really, really fun. When you open this, oh, that's it. So when you open this, you get to see whether or not the glazes worked or the colors come out right. The colors are perfect for this load. So these are my little sculptures. Earlier I mentioned about this being a part, and that doesn't really have a lot of impact, but when it's all together, like the installation I'm gonna show you later, it has a lot of the impact is stronger. So those are individuals, and they all, I work with different glazes and try to figure out the chemicals, how they would affect my surface, and then how you pull around textures or in area, recessed area. It's important for me to show the details, because I spend a lot of time designing the molds, and I want them to show. So I unloaded the kiln of those pieces today, and once they're unloaded from the kiln, I put them on the floor in clusters, so I can work from different angles to compose a shape. This one is about 4.5 feet across, so the eventual size will be 12 feet by 12 feet, so imagine this is only a third of it. So it's gonna extend all the way out, so the visual impact is stronger. And I have mentioned earlier that I emphasize on whole instead of the parts, just because, you know, I'm Asian, so we do a lot of connectiveness. So by itself, it's beautiful. I think that's a beautiful shape, and the color is nice, and the glaze did what I wanted to do. It pulled, it breaks just nicely, and then the texture is exactly what I want it to be. And oftentimes when people come to my studio, they can't help but pick those up and then kind of put them in their hands and play around. It's very tactile. But the whole is more beautiful than just one single diatom. And when I'm composing this, I put everything on the floor. So when I'm composing an installation, I think about design elements and principles. There are some principles I use more and some less. The one thing I really focus on is the lines. I want the lines to be very consistent. And you can see the texture I put on. That makes the line not a straight line and clean line anymore. It has those textures. So line now is this. And because of that, now it creates a very beautiful negative space right here. And that goes with every one of them. So now this becomes a shape. And when it's in a gallery, when this is in the gallery and with a nice floor and nice lighting, it casts a shadow onto those spaces, and they become something people, you know, the viewers can come in and start asking questions. And I mentioned about the dialogue. It's important to think about the dialogues you want people to think about, not controlling, but just for them to think about, okay, this is what I take away from this. And then why are the colors the way they are and shape the way they are? And they can see them as individuals or as a whole. So for me, the dialogues you can have with an installation is stronger than just the sculpture itself. So they become part of my visual language. So for this piece, this is only 2 by 2, 2 feet by 2 feet. And how I achieve this effect of floating is simply using a piece of mirror. And I'm using the knowledge I learned from science class. So mirrors can reflect and glass can refract. So when I put these two together, the mirror and the glass together will refract and reflect. And that's how you see the effects on the surface. So it looks like they are floating on the water. So think about your visual language. What do you want people to understand? What do you want people to read? How do you want people to read your language? So give it some thought to think, how do I enter this dialogue? So I hope what I have shared with you is beneficial to your learning. The things you are learning in high school have tremendous value, either for personal growth or academic training. Stay healthy, and I would love to do this again with you in person after the restrictions are taking off because of COVID-19. So stay safe and stay healthy. Bye. Have fun.